This is the Truth Frequency Radio Network. We are TFR.
Truth Frequency Radio.
But God answered, "And you, O angels, if you were in the lower world, you too would sin." And he sent them on earth, and then they fell, as says the book of Genesis. And it came to pass that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. After they had sinned, they were given bodies of flesh. For an angel who spends 7 days on earth becomes opaque and substantial. And when they had been clothed with flesh and with a corrupt nature, then they spake the word Shemhab Forash, and sought to regain their former place, but could not, and were cast out into the mountains there to dwell. From these angels descend the sons of the giants and the Anakim, and from their seed also spring the devils. Rabbi Eliezer says that the giants sprang from the union of the angels with the daughters of Cain, who walked about in immodest clothing and cast their eyes around with bold glances. In the book of Zena Arena, in the Parash Shikayath, says that Og sprang from this connection, and that Samael, the angel, was the parent of Og, but that Sihon was the son of the same angel who deceived the wife of Ham when she was about to enter the ark. Welcome, friends. I'm your host, Zen Garcia. This is Secrets Revealed here on Truth Frequency Radio. And I welcome you and thank you for taking the time to join us this evening. I am going to be speaking about the sons of God and classing this teaching in two different manners. One, the sons of God connected to the rebel angels and the fallen watchers, and they're united as the forces of legion here upon the earth, and that Paul references them as the powers, the principalities, the rulers of darkness and wickedness in high places. And we see a depiction of them in the currency, in the U.S. currency, with the eye that is detached and hovering above the rest of what is the brick and mortar structure of the pyramid, the Illuminati Masonic pyramid that represents the compartmentalization and the institution of humanity below, and being the foot soldiers of the eye, which represents, again, these powers, these principalities, these rulers of darkness and the wickedness in high places, the demiurge, the eye of Horus, the eye of Ra, that these rebel angels, which abandoned their first estate long ago, that the Most High had established humanity in their place, and being a little less than the angels, in that we were clothed in human form, to give us opportunity of coming into the flesh and being tried and tempted by the forces of good and evil and the duality of light and darkness here in this world where spirit is united to the material, that it is here that we can prove our allegiance and return to our former estate and be a reestablished in the glory of our former bright nature. And this ordinance, this place of habitation, the New Jerusalem, where the righteous dwell even now, this is that place which the sons of God, the rebel angels, the fallen ones, had abandoned and were cast out and exiled, extirpated from so long ago. And so this evening I want to speak about kind of our preexistence as and connected to the sons of God, and that we were also bright natured before being excluded from paradise. That Adam and Eve, when they fell, they brought on a curse for what would be the children of humanity and the bloodlines, the lineages that would be born into this fallen world through the two bloodlines, that of the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent. And that this enmity that began with the war in heaven, the extreme hostility between Christ and Satan, between the Godhead, the Holy Triune Godhead, and that of Legion, that this war would be ongoing and would play out during the Second World Age here upon the earth. And that being clothed in flesh form, that we would enter into this world and be sentenced, as it says in Psalms 82, to die the death of a man. But that certainly in our former incarnation and our previous embodiment, that we were like the angels, and that we will be returning to our former glory once we are redeemed through Christ as Savior Messiah. And so I'm going to explain a little bit of these concepts and speak about these things, and also cite the differences between what are the fallen angels and those that are condemned and that have no part in salvation, and that of humanity as angels that are fallen but not condemned and have opportunity to be redeemed through Christ. There is a huge difference between the two, even though the concepts seem very similar. The thing with the fallen angels is that they know that they are condemned and that they will be annihilated at the end game, and that there is no redemption for them, nor chance for such redeeming. Nor do they even at this point want to be redeemed. They have resigned themselves to the fate and to carry out in fullness the destiny assigned to them by not only the judgment of condemnation brought upon them by the Most High God, but also with the free will pact that they entered into in deciding to take on this role, in trying to be like the Most High, in trying to elevate themselves above the stars and the clouds and the seat of authority of the Most High God. And so, for such conviction, judgment has been placed upon them, and they no longer can return to their former state, nor do they even have access to the upper worlds? As I had mentioned in the opening quotation, which comes from a book called The Legends of the Patriarchs and the Prophets. It's a section on and about the giants, and about how if you want to know more about the Genesis 6, the sons of God, mating with the daughters of man, creating a race of giants known as the men of renown, and how these daughters of men were specifically the women and children of Cain, being hybrid himself, that made possible the union of the fallen ones being placed into flesh form with the already hybrid children of Cain. And so, which interestingly enough, and I didn't even read the fullness of the chapter that are specific to this particular subject, but my daughter-in-law Joy, she did reformat and republish this material in 14-point font and placed it in our inventory of extra biblical and esoteric manuscripts for public consideration. And so you can go to sacredwordpublishing.com and find there what is the newly released volumes of The Legends of the Patriarchs and the Prophets, which it's one of my most favorite manuscripts with regard to the commentary on all of the stories of the Old Testament and the patriarchs and the Old Testament characters, and the added detail of what has been lost in translation from the modern English, along with the Targum, which is another one of my most favorite resources. There's another that we are working on completing, the Perk de Rabbi Eleazar, which one of the quotes here is from that particular text. And also, my friend Carol, she just finished translating the Assatur, the Secret Book of Moses, which is itself a wonderful resource and contains many connections and allusions to texts and manuscripts that are no longer available in the modern age. And so reading the footnotes and the specific connections of whatever it was that Moses Gaster, who was one of the foremost translators of the ancient materials during his time, that he was the author or the translator of this manuscript, which is very old, dates back 2nd, 3rd century BC, and the numerous footnotes and sources cited therein of, again, material that is no longer available. It gives you great insight and so much resource on even the story of the giants, the fallen angels, the two different bloodlines, all those things that are little known about, but really coming to light in this day and age with our being the final in the fig tree generation, that the Most High God has opened the minds and the consciousness of humanity to have and to pique our interest in these particular topics. And that certainly an exposition on who the fallen angels are and how they're interdiction into the affairs of humanity led to what was this, the creation of this hybrid race of hominoid humanoid beings that here engaged with us in the presence of this world, that they were our mortal enemies. And they had been forever long. Certainly there are stories of benevolent giants and certain, perhaps even smaller, minor populations of giants that had befriended and even intermingled in and became the chieftains of certain groups of native peoples. But there were always, in the annals of history, a record of the cannibal giants that lusted after the flesh and would steal and abduct for wives human women, and that would subject them brutally to rape and torture and to subservience within their households. And these kind of stories can be even be, you know, can be gleaned even into the modern age with the stories of the Solomon Islander peoples and of a book that was recently put out by a Marius Borhanian, I believe his name is, The Mysteries of the Solomon Island Giants and UFOs. I believe that's the title of the text. But in that story, in the different accounts that he brings up from the different islanders that he intermarried into, being the first white man to intermarry into those native peoples, and his wife being the daughter of one of the chiefs of the island, he then became privy to a lot of this information, which he then put into this particular book, revealing how even now that the giants live and exist upon the island, and that they had been cannibals and used to abduct and steal, and as I said, to take wives from the coastal peoples there, and how the giants lived in the interior of the islands and the human populations, mostly on the outskirts, because of their fear to travel into the interior, that there's even stories of women that being abducted and kept as slave for menial work as well as for sexual purposes by these particular beings, and that they could only mate and copulate with them when they were younger and of smaller size, but that after they, you know, grew, they were no longer able to engage in intercourse with these women, but that there's even stories of them having escaped years later and surviving, bringing forth the stories of what they had undergone. And I know, of course, that this sounds crazy and bizarre and beyond belief, but this is the reality of what I have come to learn in the research that I've done, and that we are also working right now with a lady that lives there in the Solomon Islands, and that her whole family is connected to these native peoples, and that she's working to put together a book on the ancient stories and the accounts, and that she's going to be meeting with others in a manner that Marius Borhanian did in releasing this Mysteries of the Solomon Islanders and the giants and the UFO connection there, that when I found out, and she's already going to be publishing a different book through us about the creation and a Genesis narrative, but I asked her with such access to please consider doing such a book. And then I told her about, you know, this book released by Morius, and she was highly interested. And so that has now become a focus for what would be her second book, which I think will be absolutely fantastic, and one which many people will be interested in. Because for whatever reason, Marius is not, I'm not able to contact him. And I did ask and reach out to them to try to reach and make contact with him to do interview or to ask him just about the work that he's done. But he won't respond and is not available. For whatever reason and for whatever that means. And so this evening when we come back from break, we will begin to look at what it means to be a son of God, which in my opinion, the sons of God and the differentiation between what is a child of humanity and the sons of God with regard to the angels. Even though we are both created beings, these sons of God were created before the foundations of this world. And that the spirits, even of humanity and our pre-existent embodiment, that we were also part of this category of angelic being that was manifest on the first day. And so we'll speak about that when we come back as well. But again, as I said, that it is now our opportunity, being born into flesh form, that we have a chance to be redeemed unto everlasting life, and that we have opportunity to accept and to be returned to those ordinances which the fallen angels had abandoned when they decided to try to overthrow Christ and to steal the seat of glory, to usurp the throne of glory, which really they never had a chance, because how do you challenge your maker? You know, I mean, that's just pure folly. But yet they were confident in their ability, especially in coming together in numbers, that the powers that they had and the vanity of their pride led them to believe in such manner that they could overthrow the creator of all things. Which again is just pure foolishness, but Lucifer was able to tempt one third of the angels of the Most High to join him in such insurgency. And that his glory was so great and so appealing that many did believe and joined him in pact, and deceiving himself, he deceived them. And so when we come back, we'll go into that particular aspect of the story. Let me see if I have time to finish up this quotation. And I just want to again, thank all of you for taking the time to join us this evening. I think I do have a little bit of time to. The rest of the quote Hear and fear not, Enoch, thou righteous man and writer of righteousness. Come hither and hear my words. Go speak unto the watchers of heaven, and say unto them, ye shall pray for men and not men for you. Why have ye forsaken the high and holy and eternal heaven, and have joined yourselves to women, and polluted yourselves with the daughters of men, and have taken to you wives, and have become the fathers of a giant race? Ye who were spiritual, holy, and enjoying eternal life, have corrupted yourselves with women, and have become parents of children with flesh and blood. Lusting after the blood of men, ye have brought forth flesh and blood, like those who are mortal and perishable. All right, I'll finish this up when we come back to break. Be right back. All right, welcome back, everybody. And so the passage that I was reading from, even though it's from the Legends of the Patriarchs and the Prophets, you can find this quoted also in chapter 15, I believe, of the Book of Enoch, which this is also what Christ was referencing in Matthew chapter 22, verse 30, I believe it is, when he was speaking about the angels not marrying or given in marriage, but not that they couldn't sleep with or copulate with the daughters of Cain, because certainly that did happen. And the result of that was that the race of giants was conceived from such unholy matrimony. But that here he, and I'll continue, ye who were spiritual, holy, and enjoying eternal life have corrupted yourselves with women and have become parents of children with flesh and blood. Lusting after the blood of men, ye have brought forth flesh and blood like those who are mortal and perishable. Because men died, therefore did I give unto them wives, that they might have sons and perpetuate their generation. But ye are spiritual and in the enjoyment of eternal life. Therefore give I not to you wives, for heaven is the abode of the spirits. And now the giants who are born of flesh and blood shall become evil spirits, and their dwelling shall be on the earth. Bad beings shall proceed from them, because they have been generated from above. From the holy watchers have they received their origin. Therefore shall they be evil spirits on the earth, and evil spirits shall they be called. And the spirits of the giants which mount upon the clouds will fail and be cast down, and do violence, and cause ruin on the earth and injury. They shall not eat, they shall not thirst, and they shall be invisible. All right. So what I wanted to read now to kind of set the premise for what we're going to be going into is the conflict of Satan and therefore I fell, which is from the first book of Adam and Eve. And it explains the transition, because as I was speaking about humanity and Adam and Eve specifically, that they were initially created in a bright nature, and they were clothed with what are cited in the Targum as the vestures of honor. And it was when they were tempted by Satan to eat fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that's what caused them to take on mortality, human flesh, and to then, in Eve's case, to be impregnated, that she was tempted to engage in sexual promiscuity, with Satan, and he beguiling her, which means wholly seduced, basically stole her chastity. And that, not knowing really what was going on, that she had no idea as to what she was engaged in. And so she was led astray into copulating with him, and then repeating the act with Adam. She then becomes further impregnated with Abel, the two fraternal twins from two different fathers. And so that's what happens when the Lord God confronts them. He sees and already knows that being tempted and having fallen, that Eve is pregnant with these twins, and that each would represent two different bloodlines. One, the children of Adam, the generations of Adam, found listed in Genesis chapter 5. You know, we see in different other portions of history with Isaac and Ishmael, even though they're different children from the same father but different mothers. And then you have Jacob and Esau from the same father and the same mother, but still the enmity and the division between these two bloodlines carried out between these two people groups, the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent, that it plays out in a similar manner, and that Christ said in Matthew 13, let both grow together until the time of the end. And then at the time of the end, he would separate the harvest. He would gather the tares, the children of the devil, gather them for condemnation, and the children of light, the wheat, those that would be preserved. He would gather them for preservation. It says this: and then came the word of God to Adam and Eve, and raised them from their dead state, saying unto them, why came ye up hither? Or you intend to go into the garden from which I brought you out? It cannot be today, but only when the covenant I have made with you is fulfilled. And then Adam, when he heard the word of God, and the fluttering of the angels whom he did not see, but only heard the sound of them with his ears, he and Eve wept and said to the angels, O spirits who wait upon God, look upon me and upon my being unable to see you. For when I was in my former bright nature, then I could see you. I sang praises as you do, and my heart was far above you. But now that I have transgressed, that bright nature is gone from me, and I am come to this miserable state, that I cannot see you, and you do not serve me as you were wont, for I am become animal flesh. Yet now, O angels of God, ask God with me to restore me to that where I was formerly, to rescue me from this misery, and to remove me from the sentence of death he passed upon me for having trespassed against him. And then when the angels heard these words, they all grieved over him and cursed Satan who had beguiled Adam until he came from the garden to misery, from life to death, from peace to trouble, and from gladness to a strange land. And then the angel said unto Adam, thou didst hearken to Satan, and didst forsake the word of God, who created thee, and thou didst believe that Satan would fulfill all that he had promised thee. But now, O Adam, we will make known to thee what came upon us through him before his fall from heaven. He gathered together his hosts and deceived them, promising them and other promises, promising them to give them a great kingdom, a divine nature, and other promises he made them. His hosts believed that his word was true, and so they yielded to him and renounced the glory of God. He then sent for us according to the orders in which we were to come under his command and to hearken to his vain promise, but we would not. And we took not his advice. And then, after he had fought with God and had dealt forwardly with him, he gathered together his hosts and made war with us. And if it had not been for God's strength that was with us, we could not have prevailed against him to hurl him from heaven. But when he fell from among us, there was great joy in heaven because of his going down. For had he continued in heaven, nothing, not even one angel, would have remained in it. But God, in his mercy, drove him from among us to this dark earth, for he had become darkness itself and a worker of unrighteousness. And he has continued, O Adam, to make war against thee, until he beguiled thee and made thee come out of the garden to this strange land, where all these trials have come to thee, brought upon him. He is also brought to thee, O Adam, because thou didst obey him and didst transgress again. Then the angels rejoiced and praised God and asked him not to destroy Adam this time for his having sought to enter the garden, but to bear with him until the fulfillment of the promise, and to help him in the world until he was free from Satan's. A little bit more about the fall. Because another thing with regard to the first book of Adam and Eve, if you read it, you will see how it specifies in great detail the differences of Adam and Eve in their former bright nature, in their former estate, in their glory of what was their unconditional immortality at that time. But here we see that now they have, in walking and being cast out of paradise, they have to even walk on their feet. And that was something that was not required of them in moving in heaven. And so I'm guessing, you know, that we're able to float or to move by thinking about it rather than performing a physical action. And that the other things with regard to their discomfort and displeasure with the cold and the heat, then also the other elements as far as the rain, the storms, and especially the cold, you know, because they were unused to just the experience of the cold in that manner. And so just a little bit more, and we'll end this particular text with what Satan tells Adam of why it is that he is waging war against him. Then came the word of God to Adam and said unto him, O Adam, look at that garden of joy and at this earth of toil, and behold the angels who are in the garden that is full of them, and see thyself alone on this earth with Satan whom thou didst obey. Yet if thou hadst submitted and been obedient to me and hadst kept my word, thou would be with my angels in my garden. But when thou didst transgress and hearken to Satan, thou didst become his guest among his angels that are full of wickedness. And thou camest to this earth that brings forth to thee thorns and thistles. O Adam, ask him who deceiveth thee to give thee the divine nature he promised thee, or to make thee a garden as I had made for thee, or to fill thee with that same bright nature with which I had filled thee. Ask him to make thee a body like the one I made thee, or to give thee a day of rest as I gave thee, or to create within thee a reasonable soul as I did create for thee, or to remove thee hence to some other earth than this one which I gave thee. But, O Adam, he will not fulfill not even one of the things he told thee. Acknowledge then my favor towards thee and my mercy on thee, my creature, that I have not required thee for thy transgression against me. But in my pity for thee, I have promised thee that at the end of the great 5.5 days, half I will come and save thee. Then God said again to Adam and Eve, arise, go down hence, lest the cherub with a sword of fire in his hand destroy you. But Adam's heart was comforted by God's word to him, and he worshiped before him. And God commanded his angels to escort Adam and Eve to the cave with joy instead of the fear that had come upon them. And then the angels took up Adam and Eve and brought them down from the mountain by the garden with songs and psalms until they brought them to the cave. There the angels began to comfort and to strengthen them, and then departed from them towards heaven to their creator who had sent them. But after the angels were gone from Adam and Eve, came Satan with shamefacedness and stood at the entrance of the cave in which were Adam and Eve. He then called to Adam and said, O Adam, come and let me speak to thee. And then Adam came out of the cave thinking he was one of God's angels that was come to give him some good council. But when Adam came out and saw his hideous figure, he was afraid of him and said unto him, Who art thou? And then Satan answered and said unto him, It is I who hid myself within the serpent, and who talked to Eve and beguiled her until she hearkened to my command. I am he who sent her through the wiles of my speech to deceive thee, until thou and she ate of the fruit of the tree, and you came away from under the command of God. But when Adam heard these words from him, he said unto him, Canst thou make me a garden as God made for me? Or canst thou clothe me in the same bright nature in which God had clothed me? Where is the divine nature thou didst promise to give me? Where is that fair speech of thine thou didst hold with us at first when we were in the garden? And then Satan said unto Adam, Thinkest thou that when I have spoken to one about anything, I shall ever bring it to him or fulfill my word? Not so, for I myself have never even thought of obtaining what I asked. And therefore did I fall, and did I make you fall by that for which I myself fell. And with you also, whosoever accepts my counsel falls thereby. But now, O Adam, by reason of thy fall, thou art under my rule, and I am king over thee, because thou hast hearkened to me and hast transgressed against thy God. Neither will there be any deliverance from my hands until the day promised thee by thy God. Again he said, Inasmuch as we do not know the day agreed upon with thee by thy God, nor the hour in which thou shalt be delivered, for that reason will we multiply war and murder upon thee and thy seed after thee. This is our will and our good pleasure, that we may not leave one of the sons of men to inherit our orders. For as to our abode, O Adam, it is in burning fire, and we will not cease our evil doing, no, not one day nor one hour. And I, O Adam, shall sow fire upon thee when thou comest into the cave to dwell there. When Adam heard these things, he wept and mourned and said unto Eve, Hear what he said, that he will not fulfill aught of what he told thee in the garden. Did he really then become king over us? But we will ask God who created us, deliver us out of his hand. Okay, and that's the first book of Adam and Eve. Chapter 55, verses 1 through chapter 57, verses 12. And so you see that they had become subject and under the authority of Satan and the other rebel angels, that they were cast down to paradise, and that they dwell where the other fallen ones had already been cast down to. And you notice that in those verses, they say that they will multiply war and murder upon the descendants of Adam, and they will continue, and they will continue in evil in such manner so that not one of these sons of humanity inherit their ordinances in heaven. Those places, their former bright nature, their former glory which they had, and of which they were lost when they were cast down. A lot to consider from that particular chapter and that particular, those verses. And so when we return from break, we'll be speaking about what it is to be redeemed through Christ and why it is that he had to come into the flesh in order to rectify the fall and to restore us to our former state. We'll be right back. All right, welcome back, everybody, for a second hour. I'm your host, Zen Garcia. This is Secrets Revealed here on Truth Frequency Radio. And this evening, we are speaking about our former estate, paradise, as the place of the righteous and the place where both the rebel angels and also Adam and Eve and humanity had all been privy to inhabitation, but first the angels fell in wanting to overthrow Christ, and that this took place at the very beginning of what is the light, separation of light and darkness. And in Psalms 82, it tells us that the foundations of darkness were out of place. And when we look at Genesis, we see that this is exactly what is referenced in verse 1 and 2, where the war in heaven had led to the destruction of the earth. And this is also when they were cast down in exile on the second day, according to the second book of Enoch. Chapters 29 and 30, you can find in there that it specifies that it was on the second day that they were cast down and exiled here to the earth, and that once they had been condemned in such manner that they then found themselves under the authority of death, and that they too would have to die the death of man, which is, you know, we see in Isaiah 14 and Ezekiel chapter 28 that they would have to, you know, basically take on embodiment. But at the end of days and at the end of their lifetime, that basically for Satan, as it says in Isaiah 14 and Ezekiel 28, that a fire would be brought from within him to consume him from the inside out, and that he would be, it would be like spontaneous combustion. That is the sentence that would be brought upon him, and in that manner, according to scripture. But I'll read Psalm 82. It's very short. It says, God standeth in the congregation of the mighty. He judgeth among the gods, which we know that the gods, as spoken about in the scripture, that the gods are nothing but the fallen angels themselves. And also to humanity, that we were preexistent part of the sons of God before taking on embodiment. And that this is what Christ is alluded to in John chapter 10, verses 34, I believe, where he says to the Pharisees, does not your scripture say that ye are gods? Gods with the little g here. And so it's the same thing. He was actually relating and alluding in passage to Psalms 82 in those particular verses. And so, God standeth in the congregation of the mighty. He judgeth among the gods. How long will ye judge unjustly and accept the persons of the wicked, Selah? Defend the poor and the fatherless. Do justice to the afflicted and the needy. Deliver the poor and the needy. Rid them out of the hand of the wicked. They know not, neither will they understand. They walk on in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are out of course. I have said, ye are gods, and all of you are children of the Most High. But ye shall die like men and fall like one of the princes. And I believe that prince to be Satan, who Christ said in Luke chapter 10, verse 18, I saw Satan like lightning fall from heaven. Arise, O God, judge the earth, for thou shalt inherit all nations. And so, again, there's this concept that is little known about, little spoken about, and then not very widely understood. And I don't know of very many people talking about this in the manner that I do at all, that most people deny that we preexisted, and that even what Christ says in the scriptures, I knew you before the foundations of this world, meaning the current earth age, which was, you know, reestablished after what is the first destruction. Well, not the first destruction, because there were others previous, but to the ones that I'm speaking about that led to the earth becoming without form and void. And so that's what we're going to be referencing. And this is the same thing that is spoken about in Jeremiah. Let's look at that from the Blue Letter Bible. Let's examine this just a little bit closer to see if it can give us a little bit more insight. The words of Jeremiah, the son of Hilkiah, of the priests that were in Anathoth in the land of Benjamin, to whom the word of the Lord came in the days of Josiah, the son of Ammon, king of Judah, in the 13th year of his reign. Then the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee, and before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. And so, that word before is the word terem. It means before, not yet, before that. Apparently meaning to interrupt or suspend. Properly non-occurrence. Used adverbially, not yet or before. And so let's look at the next part. Before I formed. The word formed is yatsar. We've seen that in other places. It means to form, fashion, frame. The squeezing into shape, to mold into form, especially as a potter, figuratively to determine, fashion, form, frame, make, for purpose. And so, God is saying, previous to I forming you in the belly, the in the belly, look at that, in the belly. The word is baten, and it means meaning to be hollow, the belly, especially the womb, also the bosom or body of anything, belly, body, as they be born within or womb. And so he's saying before I formed thee, which is that aspect of in the body or the belly, that this is our physical, talking about our physical being. Before I formed thee in the belly, I knew. Let's look at that word knew. Knew is yada. And it means to know properly, to ascertain by seeing, used in a great variety of senses, figuratively, literally, euphemistically, and inferentially, including observation, care, recognition, and causatively, instruction, designation, acknowledge, acquaintance, advise, answer, appoint, assuredly, to be aware, certainly comprehend, consider, to be diligent, discern, discover, endued with, a familiar friend, famous, feel, can have, or be, instruct, kinsfolk, kinsmen, cause to make know, come to give, have, take knowledge, have knowledge, to be make and to be known, made self known, to be learned, lie by man, mark, perceive. And so, a prognosticator, have respect, skillful, show, be sure of a surety, teach, tell, understand, have understanding, will, be wist. And so, he's saying, I knew you. I was assured, I had known you before you ever entered into the belly of your mother, before you ever entered into your physical within the belly of your mother's womb. I knew thee. And before thou camest forth, which, camest forth, that's going to be birth, conception. Let's look it up. The word is yatsah. And it means to go or to bring out, a variety of applications, literally and figuratively, after, appear, assuredly, bear out, begotten, break out, bring forth, carry out, come abroad, to be, depart, draw forth, escape, exact, fail, fetch forth, get away, go abroad, going out, grow or have forth. And so basically to be born. And so that's exactly what is being referenced here of Jeremiah. The word of the Lord, which we know is Christ, Christ is telling him, Jeremiah, before I formed your body, within the womb of your mother, I already knew thee. And before thou camest forth, meaning before you were born out of the womb, I had already sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. Let's look at the word sanctified and ordained. Sanctified is kadosh. It means to make, pronounce, or observe as clean, ceremonially or morally, appoint, bid, consecrate, dedicate, defile, hallow, be kept holy, prepare, proclaim, purify, sanctify. And so he's telling Jeremiah, again, before you ever entered into the womb of your mother, I had already pronounced you, appointed you, consecrated you, dedicated you, and now prepared and proclaimed you. The next word is ordained. Let's look at that. All right, ordained. Nathan. That's interesting. Nathan. Ordained to means to give, use with greatest latitude of application. Add, apply, appoint, ascribe, assign, avenge, bestow, bring forth, hither, cast, cause, charge, come, commit, consider, count, cry, deliver, direct, distribute, without fail, fasten, frame, give, grant, indeed, lay charge, leave, lend, lift up, make, ordain, pay, perform, place, pour, print, all these things. And so you see again that the Most High, the Word, Christ is telling Jeremiah, before I created your physical body and before you were ever born, I had already sanctified, ordained, chosen you, proclaimed, prescribed, set you up to be a prophet unto the nations. I mean, so it should be absolutely clear there that just as I was talking about with our being a son of God before we ever came into flesh form, and that when we come into flesh form, our pre-existent souls, our spirits, are basically married and bound with what is our fallen flesh existence for that one lifetime. And so when we read and study in the scriptures what it means to be returned to be returned to a state where we are a son of God, that's what it's referencing, is that we are being restored to our former bright nature. That this is what is talked about in 1 John, or John chapter 1. In verse 10 through 12, he says, "He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God." And so he's saying that the angels, the sons of God, they were not created by being born of woman. They were created directly by God, just as Adam was before he fell. And that's why we see in the Luke chapter 3 on the lineage of Christ that Adam is linked as called a son of God because he was created directly and by God. Which that reminds me of another very interesting passage that somebody had asked me about, and I had wanted to bring it forth and to help people to understand it, because this individual didn't understand exactly what it was referencing. And so, and I forget exactly who had asked me about it, but it's a passage from the Gospel of Philip. And this is what it says. And it relates to exactly what we're talking about here. It says, he who has been created is beautiful, but you would not find his sons noble creations. If he were not created, but begotten, you would find that his seed was noble. But now he was created and he begot. What nobility is this? First, adultery came into being, afterward, murder. And he was begotten in adultery, for he was the child of the serpent. So he became a murderer, just like his father, and he killed his brother. Indeed, every act of sexual intercourse which has occurred between those unlike one another is adultery. And so consider this passage, and I'm going to help you to understand it and to make sense of it and to recognize what is being spoken about in this Gospel of Philip, which this particular passage also verifies exactly what is spoken about in Genesis chapter 3 with the serpent beguiling Eve, and also what Christ speaks about in Matthew chapter 13, where he tells you of the enemy that snuck into the garden and that sowed the tares. And so the way you have to understand this passage, consider this. He who has been created is beautiful, but you would not find his son's noble creations. All right, this is talking about Satan, because remember, he was not begotten of woman, but he was directly created, just like Adam, by the Most High God. But Satan was never supposed to marry or to have children. That's why it says of his children here, if he were not created but begotten, meaning that if he were not directly created but God, by God, but he was begotten, mean born of woman, then you would find that his seed was noble. But again, his seed, but now he was created and he begot, meaning that he, again, being a created being, an angel, he was never supposed to have children. As we read in the first passages, in the first verses, talking about how the angels, because they were spiritual and immortal, God did not give them women because they had no need to procreate and to continue their kind. But God gave to humanity and those born of woman the ability to sexually procreate and through love to create and propagate the race. And this would only be for the second world age, for the 6,000 years that, you know, we would be under the authority of death and under Satan. And so, if he were not created, meaning if he were not an angel, but begotten, meaning born of woman, you would find that his seed was noble, meaning that his children would have been normal, human children. They wouldn't have been unusual, which Cain was said to have a seraphic appearance. He was a hybrid being. That's why it is said of his lineage that they are a den of vipers and that they are serpentine in aspect. And so, what nobility is this? First, adultery came into being. Afterward, murder. So it's telling you about what happened in the garden here, that he seduced Eve and that adultery first came into being, and then afterward murder. How did murder come afterwards? Because it was through adultery that Cain was born, and then he murdered his half of Abel. All right, we'll pick it up on the other side. All right, welcome back, everybody, for final segment. I want to finish up the passage that I was talking about before we move forward. And then we'll talk about, you know, some of with regard to the loss of paradise and all of that. And so back to this particular passage. But now he was created and he begot, meaning that he, Lucifer, Satan, the adversary, was an angelic being created, not begotten of woman. So what nobility is this? First, adultery came into being and afterward murder. And as I said before we went to break, it was his seducing Eve, beguiling her, meaning wholly seduced, that she then brought forth Cain, and Cain would be a murderer. He would kill his half-brother, Abel. And then because he killed his half-brother, God would give her Seth, whose name means substitute, replacement, and that it would be through Seth that Adam's line would be propagated and that his lineage would be continued. And that's why we find in Genesis chapter 5 that Seth's lineage is continued. Adam's race is continued through Seth because Abel was murdered. And Cain and his genealogy are found in Genesis chapter 4. And the first 10 generations are therein listed. All right, continuing. First, adultery came into being, afterwards, murder, and he was begotten in adultery, meaning that, speaking about Cain, for he was the child of the serpent, and so he became a murderer just like his father, and he killed his brother. And so, I mean, it doesn't get any clearer than that. And unless you have the knowledge of which we talk about with regard to the parable of the garden and what had occurred in the garden with the seduction of Eve and her being impregnated with Cain, who, again, was the first murderer, liar, and deceiver, and after his father, he was evilly inclined, and his nature was to commit and to do evil, that this was the kind of thing that was perpetuated through the Cainites, through the children of Cain. And so, you know, that's the distinction. It even speaks about this in 1 John. It speaks about how Cain, who was of that wicked one, that word of being son of, progeny of, child of, from the other children, from Adam's children, and from his genealogy. And so that's why we see in this particular passage what we are being told, that as it says in, you know, again, in Matthew chapter 13, that the tares are, the tares are the children of the devil, of the wicked one. And that Cain, who was of that wicked one, that he is, you know, again, the patriarch. He's the progenitor of that particular bloodline. And it is, you know, these particular beings that are mostly excluded from salvation as the fallen ones who of the devil, the tares, which are excluded. From salvation. All right. We're going to finish up with a couple more passages. in Romans 8, you have this same kind of thing spoken about with regard to the difference between spirit and flesh, and that to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then, they that are in the flesh cannot please God, but ye are not in the flesh, but in the spirit. If so be that the spirit of God dwell in you, now, if any man have not the spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raises up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwelleth in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. For if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that which we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. For whom he did foreknow, here we go again, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified. So what shall we say then to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? All right, I'm going to stop there. I want to catch one more passage before we get to the end of the show. But I do recommend people read the rest of that, Romans chapter 8. The next thing I wanted to read from is Philippians chapter 2. And I'm going to end with this. And then, you know, again, it's speaking about the redemption of our flesh from an animal nature to that of a glorified being, that we will be restored to our former bright-natured angelic selves, our pre-existent, that aspect of us who we were before the fall, and that part of us that God knew even before the foundations of the world. And so this is how to understand those teachings. God is talking about us being restored to our first estate, and that we will be taking over those ordinances which the fallen angels abandoned and rebelled against and were excluded and abandoned and exiled from. And so this is also why, for those that don't understand, paradise is not of this world. Paradise is in the third heaven. And I know, I'm not going to mention any names here, but that there are certain teachers that teach contrary to this because they are spiteful, specifically of me and the things that I do teach. And but this individual is completely wrong, because paradise is specifically mentioned by Paul and others, Enoch and Peter in the Apocalypse of Peter and other places. Paradise is at the third heaven. It's above the vaulted dome. The place of the righteous is where New Jerusalem currently resides. And that is with the heavenly temple, the throne room of the Most High God. And is New Jerusalem will descend out of the heavens in that day when the firmament is rolled back like a scroll. And then Christ comes with 10,000s of his saints. And coming to bring judgment, he raptures the church and the bride, and then pours forth the wrath of God upon the wicked and those not written into the books of life. And for, I believe it will be a week of destruction, that there was a week of silence at the beginning of the creation, that there will be in similarity, that there will be this pause, this quiet, that the stars cast down here to the earth will inflame the earth. All the mountains will be brought low, the seas brought high. The earth will be made level and flat and be restored anew in fire and flame to become, in preparation, the virgin bride of Christ as he comes to take his throne and to bring judgment upon the world. And in that moment, you know, the seventh trump will sound. There will be an earthquake like never before. The elect will be preserved, and all the cities will fall upon the earth. It's said to be the greatest earthquake to ever have been, and it will destroy and bring low the cities of all the nations. And then there will be great destruction as the locust army is loosed. And the supernatural entities, the giants, also come forth to rape, pillage, plunder, and slaughter, and to decimate 2/3 of those yet remaining here upon the earth. There will be a time, a short time, where those that are judged, that have brought judgment brought upon them, they won't know what to expect. And they will be little prepared, because this is the kind of destruction, the kind of terror that has not been since the very beginning of the world. The kind of terror and destruction that all flesh that was kept out of the ark of Noah's saving grace, that the horror that they were filled with as they saw all their loved ones dying and the waters just getting higher and higher, and that there was no place for them to swim and place a foothold and to find rest, that they would have to exhaust themselves in trying to survive just to make it for a day or two. And yet we know that, according to Scripture, that the floods, it rained for 40 days and 40 nights, and that Noah was upon the waters for perhaps an entire, whether you think it's a year or whatever, it was a very long time. And so, let's finish with this. Philippians 2, and I'll just finish with the entire chapter. If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort or love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels and mercies, fulfill ye my joy, that ye may be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in the lowliness of mind let each esteem each other better than themselves. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. Do all things without murmurings and disputings, that ye may be blameless and harmless, the sons of God, without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse nation, among whom ye shine as lights in the world. And that's Philippians chapter 2. Now, I do have time to go into one last thing, and that's 1 John chapter 3. And you'll see the distinction here again of the difference between the children of God who honor, respect, and converse with one another in love, and those that fear-mongering cause division and hate and condemn in judgment. You know, again, there's this whole ministry of hate being perpetuated by some people against myself and Rob Skiba, and this is the spirit of evil in which they are working, in my opinion. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. And ye know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Whosoever sinneth hath not seen him, neither known him. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. He that committeth sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin, because he is born of God. In this the children of God are manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. For this is the message that ye heard from the beginning, that we should love one another, not as Cain, who was of that wicked one, and slew his brother. And wherefore slew he him? Because his own works were evil, and his brother's righteous. Marvel not, my brethren, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death unto life, because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer, and ye know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whose hath the world's good, and seeth his brother, have dwelleth the love of God in him. My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and in truth. And hereby we know that we are of the truth, and shall assure our hearts before him. For if our hearts condemn us, God is greater than our heart, and knoweth all things. Beloved, if our heart condemn us not, then have we confidence toward God. And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments, and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And this is his commandment, that we should believe on the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave us commandment. And he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him. And hereby we know that he abideth in us by the Spirit that he hath given us. And so we see that we've come basically to the fulfillment of what is the law and the commandment that he gave unto us, that we are to love each other, to love one another as God loves us. And as we love God, so should we love our neighbors, and even that of our enemies, that we should extend such grace and love to each other and one another in similarity. And so I pray all of you be blessed in your seeking, and that you come to remembrance on who we are, why we are here, and what all this is about, and why it is that Christ came into the flesh, into mortality, took on human form in order to redeem us and to rectify the fall. And so that's what it's all about. And that's where we are truly and really here. God bless all of you. Until next week, I just wanted to, you know, again, those of you that are living in northern climates, stay warm. Try to stay as warm as you can, because these are difficult times, you know, for the world, and the winter is very challenging, especially for the homeless. And so I do pray for those that, you know, are just trying to make it and live in this world.